thank you, Grove Church, for believing in what God is doing here at Grove. God is doing some powerful things that only He can do. And He's allowing us to see miracles happen right in front of our eyes. Thank you for giving of your finances, your service, and your prayers to this church. Your giving is making a difference in the lives of children and families and boys and girls, aunts and uncles, nieces and nephews, grandmothers and grandfathers. Thank you for what you have given this far to resource this church to be able to reach the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. While God doesn't promise you a return of physical gold for your financial gift, He does promise an eternal reward of crowns in heaven for your giving, and He gives you the ability to share it with these eternal souls that He has saved through the outreach that has been made possible through your giving. Thank you. Thank you for making it possible to make this house a house of prayer and praise and preaching. Thank you for allowing us to worship the Lord here with joy and singing. And thank you that you make it possible for the world to experience and at least taste and see that the Lord is good. Thank you for allowing us to dream God-sized dreams, for throwing a party for the city, to drop 10,000 balloons, to forecast our service around the world, to adopt technology to send our message out around the world, to do whatever it takes to draw people's attention to their need for a Savior. Thank you for giving to the Lord by resourcing and giving to this church, Grove Church. For this church is the most loving, caring, giving church. It is a Christ-proclaiming church, a gospel-preaching, a soul-reaching, Bible-teaching, Holy Spirit-depending, people-loving church. That is the church I go to. That is the church I give to, because that's the church that God is showing up at over and over and over and over again. Thank you from the bottom of my heart for giving to Grove Church. You are making an eternal difference in the lives of so many people. God is doing great things at Grove, amen. God is doing some wonderful things at Grove, and we have an opportunity to celebrate yet another miracle that God has done in the life of our Grove family. This is a beautiful story. If you're part of the Grove family, you know that we often celebrate the message of hope and salvation, that every man needs their sin forgiven. No man can save themselves. They needed a man to forgive their sin, but no man's perfect, only God is. So God came to earth in the form of a baby. We named him Jesus while he was here. He lived a perfect life. And then he went to the cross and took all of our sin that we've ever done, doing, or going to do, and paid for our own sin penalty, died on the cross, and then proved that he could forgive our sins by rising from the dead, conquering sin and death 3 days later. And today, we have the opportunity to share that hope of salvation to whoever calls upon the name of the Lord. And today I have an exciting way to start this Sunday morning worship experience by celebrating what God has done in the life of another Grove family member. This is Tucker Meredith. Tucker is 18 years old. He goes to John Tyler and lives in the area, and he's at home with his mom and his stepdad and his brother, who is in the military. And he was born in a Christian home and began to hear the truths. He engaged a lot of people in his life at clubs, at Young Life, at school, and ran into a good coach, a cross-country coach, who was really a spiritually minded person that encouraged him to think about Christ and think about salvation. He soaked all of that in. He was very interested in sincerely learning and reading the scriptures and studying and engaging people. And so finally, as he got a little bit older, he began to search for churches that related to him, churches that spoke the truth, but but made common sense. Churches that just connected with him. And he had some very, very good friends at Grove. And if you see them, they kind of sit all in a row. But you've got Zach and Sarah and Cassie and Jen and all of them. They say, you got to come to Grove. Tucker, we think you'll connect here. And as soon as he came, he fell in love with the Spirit, fell in love with the people. And then one day, we were having a house of prayer. I knelt and I prayed and we led the congregation in a prayer. And I at the end, I said, and all God's people said, amen. And then we dismissed, and Tucker said, in my heart, though, I was not done praying. I was not done doing business with the Lord. He went home that night and he began to think, now is the time. I know enough about salvation. I know enough about who my Jesus is. It's time that I accept him. And he kept that reflection prayer time going at home and knelt down and gave his heart and life to the Lord Jesus Christ. And he wants everyone to know. He wants everyone to know that Christ can change your life. We are blessed today to have his brother Hunter, who got in late last night from the infantry, the army. And Hunter, we're so glad. We appreciate your service. We're so glad that you could experience this moment with your brother. And he works at Magnolia Academy and Kids, and he wants all the kids to know that if you give your heart and life to Jesus, just trust the Lord. You may not have all the answers, but God will guide you, and he is the only way of salvation. Give your heart to him. Tucker believes he's going to work with children in ministry somehow, some way, but he wants all of them to see his life and know that they too can accept the Lord Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. So we're excited today. Would you stand in honor of what the Lord has done in the life of Tucker Merritt? Tucker, have you accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior?
Yes, I have.
Are you prepared to tell the world and all your family, friends, and loved ones that you're now a follower of Jesus Christ?
Yes, sir.
It is my great honor, my brother, to baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death. Praise in the likeness of his resurrection!
See glory to his name.
worship Christ the King. We sing glory in the highest. joyful and triumphant. Oh, come ye, oh, come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Christ the of angels singing exultation. Sing, all ye citizens of heaven above. Oh, glory to God, oh, glory to thee be all glory given. Word of the Father, now in flesh appearing. Oh, come, let us adore. Oh, sweet head, the stars in the sky look down where he lay. The little Lord Jesus asleep on the
you deserve the praise. Oh, worthy
2,000 years ago, God touched down on earth, and there was a spontaneous worship service. A worship without restraint, a worship experience without reservation, and certainly a worship experience without regret. Shepherds were in the field, watching over their flocks during the nighttime, and the whole heavenly hosts appeared and began to praise and say, "We bring you good tidings of great joy. For in the city of David, Bethlehem is born King of Kings, Lord of Lords." Shepherds, who were known for being kind of an outcast and not socially acceptable, didn't quite care at this point about who accepted them, because they just realized that the whole of heaven's angel armies were having a worship experience with them. It made the rulers of the world seem pretty puny in light of the company they were in. They turned to each other and said, "Let's go see what has come to pass." They saw this baby, newly born, swaddling clothes, just strips of cloth, and in their best way, without having too many gifts, other than dirty cloths and rods and staffs, they came. And it said that they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. Now, if you're a grammarian, there's an adverb and an adjective in that sentence. I don't think they were parsing grammar, but I want you to get the gist of what happened there. Exceeding is an adverb. Great is an adjective, meaning they rejoiced exceedingly. They didn't stop. With great joy. There's superlatives all over that description. What does that mean? It meant they were overwhelmed. They were taken over. They were full. They were moved with emotion. Have you ever been there? Where you can't even utter the words? The shepherds went back and began to publish it abroad that they had just seen the coming Messiah. They were privileged and privy to the King of Kings come to earth. A few months later, 3 to 4 at the earliest, a year, 16 months maybe, Magi come from the east. They're no longer in a manger now, they're in a house. They had already fulfilled Leviticus 12. They've already gone to the temple. They've all had purification. They've already given their offerings. We know the Magi didn't come at the time of the shepherds, because if they would have come, then when they went to the temple, they would have had enough money to give a required lamb, but they only were able to give 2 little turtle doves, which is just a kind of dove, just with fluffy little feathers for poor people that couldn't afford it. So we know the wise men didn't even show up. There was logistics, because these wise men, as soon as they got the word from the Lord that God had touched down on earth, they began to prepare. Wise men don't travel alone. Some suggest there were only 3 because of 3 gifts. Some suggest there were 12, hence the 12 days of Christmas. We don't know, but we know usually in history there was usually at least over a dozen. And they would travel with assistants and an entourage and a cavalry of soldiers. We learned last week they were king makers. In Persia, you could not become king without their approval. You had to learn their ways. You had to learn their doctrines. And only then, when you passed through the judicial system and their equivalent to the Senate and their kind of Sanhedrin type of format, then they would declare you king. Well, their king is gone in Persia right now. And all of these gentlemen began to don their royal garb and they began to proceed, because God says there is a King of Kings being born. Culturally, during that time, the whole world was anticipating a world leader. Rome was already weak as his emperor's on their deathbed. The military leader stepped down. Herod's army at that moment is on a mission. Everyone is exposed and volatile. Eastern Persia, their king is gone. Greece is hoping for the reincarnation of Plato. Everybody's leader is gone. And they thought that maybe at this time in the world's history, could there not be the golden age of a redeemer to rule the world? And it spread far and wide through the known world. And all of a sudden, these wise men began to travel in their entourage, not on camels, in strong army stallions with soldiers approaching the Jerusalem border city. They said, "We've come to worship him." Two people said they've come to worship Jesus that day. One were the wise men, one was Herod. Two had different motives. For the wise men came believing that this coming Messiah would be not just the king for the Jews, not just king of Israel, but they would be king over all of his people. And he will rule and reign and be honest in his ruling and judgment. And he would care for people and he would love them. And so they came on a mission. When they found the child, he was in the home. The language changes to the Greek word paideion, which means toddler. He was a little older at the time. And when they had the encounter with the baby Jesus, the second worship experience broke out. It says that they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. They were overwhelmed. They were moved with emotion. They were taken over by the emotion of the moment. They fell down and they worshiped him. The ancient language describes that they fell on their foreheads. King makers fell in submission to this King of Kings that was born, for they believed that he was not just the King of the Jews, but the King of all people. You see, 606 years ago, they had an encounter with a Jewish man named Daniel, and he began to rise, and all of their ancestors and their fathers and their fathers' fathers and their fathers' fathers began to learn from this Jewish man named Daniel in Daniel chapter 2, chapter 4, chapter 5, chapter 6, and they realized that all of the Magi were mentored by this Jewish man named Daniel, and Daniel was telling them that there will come one who will deliver not just the Jews, but be a king for the world. You'd be the savior for all people. And as the generations went on, the wise men began to train and they began to realize some followed their own ways, some followed the Jewish ways. And this sect that came to find Jesus were the sect of the Magi who believed in Daniel's teaching and their fathers passed it down through the generations. And they had read the prophecies of the Messiah. They believed that he was the coming king. They read in Genesis chapter 22, verse 17. They came to Jerusalem knowing this, quote, "I will certainly bless you, Abraham. I will multiply your descendants beyond number like stars in the sky and sands on the seashore. And though through your descendants, all the nations will be blessed." They studied Numbers chapter 24, verse 17. "I see him, but not here now. I perceive him," Moses says, "far in the distance. A star will rise of Jacob. A scepter will emerge from Israel. It will crush the heads of the enemy and crack the skulls of the people that want to do people wrong." Could this be the king of the world? Kingmakers thought so. They had come to Jerusalem knowing Isaiah chapter 11, verse 1. They had already studied, "Out of the stump of David's family will grow a shoot. Yes, a branch bearing fruit from the old root. And the spirit of the Lord will rest upon him. And the spirit of wisdom and understanding. And the spirit of counsel and might. The spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord will be upon him. He will give justice to the poor. And make fair decisions to the exploited. And if you're worried about his enemies coming against him, the wise men knew this, Isaiah 11, 4. The earth will shake at the force of his word. One breath out of his mouth will destroy wicked that go against him. He will wear righteousness like a belt and truth like a cloak. They had come to Jerusalem on this day knowing Jeremiah 23, verse 5. The time is coming, says the Lord, when I will raise up a righteous descendant of David's line. He will be king who rules with wisdom. He will do what is just and right throughout the whole land. And this will be his name. His name will be the Lord who is righteous. And in that day, all will be saved. They knew who they were coming to see. And they came to see the King of the Jews. And the King of the world, their Savior. And when they met him for the first time, they were overwhelmed with worship. They were moved. They couldn't control themselves. In my personal devotion, I have not a routine, but I find that the same reoccurrence still occurs. I'll sit at my table, say, and I'll play music and many of the songs we do here and pray for you and pray for my family and the team. And then I'll begin reading the scriptures. And then I'll find myself listening to the praises of the song and I'll start singing as best I can. And then I'll begin praying. And then I'll stop my prayer and I'll sing again and I'll sing out a fragment of that truth. And I'll find that I get so moved, I can't even sit down. So I'll begin to grab my Bible and I'll begin pacing the floor. And I'll be saying, God, you're so good. No formality. You know how it is. No. You're just communing with the God and the Savior of the world who's given you access to his ear. You're like, God, you've been so good. Worthy is the Lamb. You sing out a phrase, you shout out a phrase, and then you begin reading, and then you pray a little more, and then you read, and it becomes this indescribable worship experience where it's more than formality. It takes you back to the moment of the shepherds and the wise men when they were overwhelmed with exceeding great joy. You know how it is to get overwhelmed with joy. You know how it is when you love something or someone and you're moved to the point where you can't control yourself. You have no restraint. You have no regrets. You have no reservations. Why? Because it is so precious. I remember watching my girls at different functions, dance events. I mean, some of us parents, we will go to a 12-hour dance competition to watch the best 3.5 minutes of our daughter on stage. We just do it. You know, plié, pas de chat, arabesque, pirouette, 5, 6, 7, 8. You're into it. You know how it goes. And you stand up and you hoop and holler. And you throw your voice out. You start the standing O. When no one else will stand, you just clap in there in place of them. You just go for it. You know why? Because you're just so overwhelmed and moved with joy. Because your kid is the best dancer in the world and can do no wrong. These wise men came with the same level of no restraint, no regret. Look at verse 1 of Matthew chapter 2. Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the reign of King Herod. About that time, some wise men from the east arrived in Jerusalem asking, "Where is this newborn king? We saw his star rise and we have come to worship him." Notice verse 3, King Herod was deeply disturbed. They don't care. They had read the scriptures. They had had worship experience with the creator of the world. God had revealed to them that the king is born who will be the savior of the world. The Prince of Peace, the wonderful God, the Heavenly Father, everlasting Father. This king has arrived. And so they come knowing there's hostility. And they go face to face with the human being who has staked claim to that title. Herod, the king of the Jews, and they look at the man straight in his eyes and say, "I know you have the nameplate on your door, Herod, king of the Jews. We have come to meet the real king." Did they care? No. No regrets. Because when God delivers his truth, no man can go against God. They knew the scriptures. They knew these scriptures of how God will protect and provide for his people. Psalm 72, they knew that desert nomads will bow before him. His enemies will fall before him in the dust. It says in Psalm 72, verse 12, he will rescue the poor when they cry to him. He will help the oppressed. He will have no one will defend him, but he will defend them. He will feel pity for the weak and the needy. He will rescue them. He will redeem them from oppression. Long live this king. And they knew that their very presence was fulfilling Scripture. Psalm 72, verse 10. The western kings of Tarshish will come from distant land and bring him tribute. The eastern kings of Sheba and Seba will bring him gifts. All kings, verse 11, will bow down and all nations will serve him. Verse 15, long live the king. May the gold that is given to him and may the people that pray for him bless him all the day long. Verse 17, may the king's name endure forever. May it continue as long as the sun shines. May all the nations bless through him that might praise him. Praise the Lord God of Israel, who does wonderful things. His glorious name is forever. The whole earth is filled with his glory. They knew who they were coming to, and they did not worry about anyone or anything around them. Look at verse two again. It says, where is this newborn king, king of the Jews? We've seen his star, and we have come to worship him. In verse three, King Herod was deeply disturbed, because people are not seeking him out. They're wanting another authority. Herod calls them privately, asks them, tell us where he is. When you find him, I want to worship him too. But we find out later in the chapter that he wanted to kill every boy 2 years old and under to snuff out this king. The wise men knew exactly what Herod was all about. They had heard in their Persian country that Herod had killed a bunch of people, whoever opposed his name. They heard that he killed his wife, his son, two sons, his other son, his high priest. They heard that he killed all of his leaders, whoever was a threat to their authority. So they came street smarts. They came with a cavalry of soldiers, multiple wise men. They were packing heat, frankly. They knew his army was out on a mission. They knew Rome's emperor was on his deathbed. They knew that they had the authority and they had just won two battles in the north and south. So they came at the very moment where Herod couldn't touch them. God gave them cover and protection. But they came with a mission saying, you're not understanding something. We are not leaving until we find this king of the Jews, the king of kings and lord of lords. They knew Herod was scared. They knew he was troubled. So he calls him privately and he says, now go. Now when you find him, come back to me. And the wise men said, not a chance. And they go out and they find him. Look at verse 8. Then he told them, go to Bethlehem and search carefully for the child. And when you find him, come back so I can worship him too. Verse 9, after the interview, the wise men went their way and the star they had seen in the east guided them to Bethlehem. And it went ahead and stopped over the place where the child was. Verse 10, and when they saw the star, they were filled with joy. They were exceedingly rejoicing with great joy. You cannot put it in stronger language. They were overjoyed and overwhelmed with what God was doing there. Let me read you the translations that read that verse. Matthew 2:10, when they saw the star, they were overjoyed. When they saw the star, they were filled with joy. We don't know how to translate this because it's such a superlative phrase. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. They rejoiced with great delight. They were overwhelmed with joy. They were overjoyed beyond measure. They rejoiced with exceeding great joy. They rejoiced with very great joy. They were ecstatic with joy. One translation says they were overjoyed. They shouted joyfully. They were overwhelmed with joy at the sight that filled them with intense joy. One translation says they were marvelously glad, and even one translation says they were extremely well pleased. Put it in your own words. When you come face to face with the one that's going to right some wrongs, when you come face to face with the one that's going to soon offer salvation to all of your countrymen, when you're coming face to face with the delivered promised one who's actually going to quell all of the violence and all of the injustice, and he's going to rise up and he's going to offer salvation for every single person in the world, how would you feel? And when their job is back in Persia to declare who will be a human king, they came to declare that this one is indeed the Savior of the world. And when they saw that king, look at verse 11. They entered his house. They saw the child. They bowed down, prostrate. They fell and their foreheads pressed to the ground. They worshiped him and they didn't even care about if they're muddying up their garb. Their fancy robes and regalia. No restraint, no regrets. They were worshiped him, and then they gave gifts to him. They gave gifts, gold, money, frankincense, perfume, as everyone carried perfume around in those days, very expensive. Myrrh, which is interesting, it is a seasoning and a scent flavor that was put in oil to anoint kings with. They were ready to do it right there and probably did. They bowed down and saw the one who was going to make so much life change. And 2,000 years later, I'm in my dining room having the same kind of worship experience that they did. No restraint, no reservation, no regret, because I don't have to be in the physical presence of a baby to experience that. I don't need the heavenly host to open up the heavens in order to experience. If you are a child of God and have given your heart and life to Jesus, he says, "For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature will be able to separate you from the love of God." Where two or three are worshiping him, he's right here. He's right here. So how can we not worship him without restraint? How can we not make our worship experience devoid of formality and just filled with the type of worship that struck the hearts of the Magi? How do we make our worship experiences such that we just commune with him and we sing to him and pray and read and sing and shout and read and pause and reflect and hit our knees and praise him? How can that not be our worship experience? Because we have seen this Jesus do miracles in our lives. Has he not healed you? Has he not shown himself faithful so many times to us? Has he not mended enough families to prove to us that he will come through again? Have he not showed us through and come through and parted waters in our lives? Has he not made a way? Has he not showed us that he cares when no other people care? How can we not worship him like that? Not coming to church in a formality. How can we not have a worship experience that loves him? That says, "I don't care who's around. I don't care who is looking, because what I am worshiping and the person I am worshiping is too important for me not to cast down on my knees and my face and say, 'God, you are worthy.'" How can we not worship him? Have we not seen that the God, the creator of the world, has made a way for us, has healed us, has comforted our hearts, has brought us salvation? The God we run to and trust with all that we have. How can we not worship him? Let's worship him this morning. Praise him without restraint. Worship.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. You're working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. You're moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. You're working in place. I worship you. I worship you. Come on, you sing this.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you
We've
are.
We've come, Lord, to call upon your name. We call you. Waymaker, miracle worker,
light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
My God, you are here, touching every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You're here, healing every heart.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when
you and the Lord this morning. So whatever we've got to do to focus, do that. Close your eyes. Jesus, we look to you and only you. We've got to have your presence, Lord. The scriptures say, my grace is sufficient for you. For my power is made perfect in your weakness. His grace is sufficient.
That's what Christmas is about. That's what Grove Church is about. Worship Him. Worship Him. Without restraint, without regret, without reservation. That's what Christmas is about. Worship Him. I hope you have a great worship experience all the way to Christmas. God bless you, Grove family. You're dismissed.